Hey guys, so the agenda for this module is to make contact with the philosophy of this whole course, computational thinking. So now that we have developed the theory of random walks and in fact solved the random walk problem for all practical purposes for the discrete version in 1D, and then we have seen how the generalizations of this to 3D is possible. So now it is time to implement this on Mathematica, right? So that's the agenda for this. We will do a numerical simulation and verify the main results. What is the main result which we got from the random walk discussion so far? It's that the average distance covered by a random walker walking in 1D is the typical distance is actually like square root of n, right? So we will verify this systematically, numerically now. Okay, so in order to do this, so let's first consider the unbiased random walk problem and then we can generalize it. So there is this very nice simple approach to writing a code for this. You can actually first generate a random walk, visualize it. So let's say I create an array of size 1. I have just one element in it, and now I can use this do command along with append to generate a random walk. So let me actually run this first and then I will explain to you what is going on. So I'm claiming that this generates for me a random walk, an unbiased random walk with of size 500. So let me actually first tell you what each of these commands is doing. If I use random choice, I should use input. If I do random choice, so this is a Mathematica function, I can give it, you know, some array of possibilities. So here I'm saying it's either +1 or -1. So -1, 1. So if I, there should be choice. Yeah, so if I run it again, then you see it's a -1 again. So I can actually make a table of this if you want. So if I make a table of this, let us say I run it 100 times. So you see that there are a bunch of ones and a bunch of minus ones, right? And each of them is equally probable. So I can in fact make a histogram of this and check this histogram of this and check that, you know, +1 and -1 are equally probable. Maybe this is not even such a illuminating graph to see, but anyway, we will see in a moment that indeed both 1 and -1 are equally probable. So you accept that indeed this random choice is a good pseudo random number generator, and it gives for you either +1 or -1. So now let's look at what my code is doing. I'm claiming that I can start an array with just one element, and that is 0. And then append 2. What does append 2 do? So if I do append, so let's check this append 2. Let me define some array. So if I have a equal to, maybe not this. So let me say temp is equal to. Actually, let me use this table of, since we have already learned this. So I will do random choice. And the options are -1 and +1. And how many of this? Let's say I enter 100 of this. I have created an array and I have called it temp. Now I will use this append. I should make this also input. Append 2 of. Temp, then let's say I'll add 10, or I want to incorporate one more element into this array. So that's what I'm saying it does. So now you look at this array, it has all these ones and minus ones and so on, and now you see one more 10 has come in. So if I do it again, So you have the 10 is there and also 100 has come in. Then I can keep on adding any number I want, you know, like, I don't know, 5, for example. So you see that that's what this append to does. It takes an array and then it includes one more element into it, right? So having familiarized ourselves with this append to array, so now let's look at the logic of this code, right? What is it doing? It is saying, initially I start an array with just 0 in it, nothing else. And then after, then there's a do command. You can look up the syntax of the do command. I think it's intuitive. So basically n goes from 2 all the way up to 500. So it will take the n minus 1th element. So in the initial case, first value of n is 2. So n minus 1 is 1. So and that is just 0. It takes the previous element and adds either plus 1 or minus 1. That's what a random walk is, right? So it, and then it stores all this information. So initially you're going to have 0. So then in fact we can look at A, what it looks like if you want. I mean, but that's it's even better to just plot it, no? That's what we have done here. So let me generate it again. So you see you get a different random walk. A third time you get another random walk. This is something that you can play with and check for yourself that indeed it is giving, it is it's a reasonable random walk generator. Okay, so having shown you a simple one-line code with using a do loop to generate a random walk, now what we want to see is our goal is to test for this average of m squared is equal to n result. So such structures are commonly encountered in the study of polymers, stock prices, you know, time series data, trajectories of Brownian particles, right? Very important result which connected, you know, the statistical mechanics to these kind of random walk models, diffusive motion and so on. So our goal here is to verify that average of m squared is equal to n is a reasonable result using numerics. So in order to do this, let me just show you the code first and then I will explain what is going on, right? So I generate, so this time I'm going to generate a table of 1 comma minus 1 n, right? If I just sum, so either I can do it like here, which is, you know, I can keep on appending to it the sum of the previous you know, the latest point I am, I can add plus 1 or minus 1 to it and give you this kind of data, which is actually storing information about where the particle is after the n step, right? This is one kind of data, which is generating data, which is useful. But here, let me generate just a table with, you know, information about whether I went to the right or left. So that's what this central part of this code is, right? Like always in Mathematica, you must go inwards out to understand a piece of code. So this one is generating for you a series of ones and minus one. Having got it, I can just sum it, no? That's what this is doing. The total is a post-processing operation. So the sum of this is indeed the position of your particle. You have a bunch of ones and minus ones. You just add all of them. It tells you where you are, right? So I could have, of course, used this method to generate this as well, but that's just another way of doing it. Now, having done this, what I want to do is, I want to make 10,000 such tables, because ultimately I want to average over, you know, m squared. I create 10,000 such m's. So this is already m. The sum is basically where I am. After, you know, if I take n going from 100 to 1000 in steps of 100, right, for every value of n, and then I have to do this mean. I evaluate this and then I compute this average. So this average is computed over such 10,000 such samples. Basically, I'm generating 10,000 random walks, and for each random walk, I'm just computing m squared. That is done here, right? You see, basically, I can generate a whole, you know, I can take the square of a whole array. That's what I'm using here. And then I compute it numerically, and then I have, and I'm also doing a mean of that quantity, right? All of this, I want you to, you know, take away each part of this code and understand for yourself that you actually do really do understand. And then finally, I'm making another table, right? There's a whole bunch of tables, but I want you to individually understand each table and then see that, oh, it all makes sense. So finally, what is this table doing? This table is storing information about n and mean of m squared, basically. That's all. This entire thing, starting from here all the way up to here, is, you must think of it as just one number. So this outermost table is storing n and this big number, given that n goes from 100 to 1000 in steps of 100. And finally, I can just go ahead and plot this, right? So let me plot this. So it's going to take a minute, I think, because this is somewhat of a large run. Since I'm using 10,000. So there you go. I have a perfect straight line. What am I plotting? I'm plotting average of m squared. And I see that it goes, indeed, it seems to go linearly with n, and it sits on top of this. In fact, it's not just linear, but it has the correct slope as well, right? It is exactly equal to n. I have plotted this function x going from 0 to 1500, and it seems to agree excellently with the analytical result. So in fact, we can do better. We can actually work out the numerical histogram associated with this. So we know not only that the mean of m squared is equal to n, but we also in fact know the distribution Pn of m, right? So let's use this histogram and use it in PDF mode, probability distribution function mode. So this is something that you should look up, right? Histogram can work in many different modes. You can check the documentation on this. So here we have a probability distribution function. And I have already computed this quantity earlier in the previous module. You can check. I have shown how this probability distribution is given by this Gaussian function. And then I can just go ahead and, yeah, so you have to introduce this bin size. This is also sometimes a cause for confusion. Bin size is gives you freedom on how you, you take all the data that you have and you have to put them into various bins and create a numerical probability distribution. So you have some freedom there. That also is something that you can play with. I have just chosen my nmax and in bin size like here. You can pause the video and try to mimic this and also understand what is going on here. So I have a histogram. So this part is the same. It's just simply the table of ones and minus ones is the random walk. And then I generate this data. So let me plot this. There you go. So it sits right on top of the analytical curve. And it's extra justification that both our analytical work is correct and the numerical approach also seems to be reasonable. So in fact, you can now extend this. You can take p to be different from half. You can consider a biased random walk. So I have chosen p to be 0.55, but you can choose it to be whatever. Now, instead of just using random choice, I am using this is my way of generating a random number which with probability p will take you to the right and with probability 1 minus p will take you to the left, right? So it is 1 minus 2 times unit step of random real. Random real will just give you a random number between 0 and 1 drawn from a uniform distribution between 0 and 1, and then you have to subtract p and then take a unit step 1 and then multiply by 2, 1 minus 2 times this. You should go back and you should convince yourself that indeed this is the right expression. I have checked this and I can tell you that indeed it will give you a biased random walk. It will give you, you can think of it as, just this part. Take this part apart and run it many, many times. And you will check, you can do a numerical experiment to check that if you take, 100 such random numbers, probably 55 of them will be plus one and only 45 will be minus 1. That's what is expected. Or you can do even more, right? You can do a Monte Carlo simulation on this to check that it is indeed giving you the right statistics. So that's the way pseudo random number generators are checked, distributions, whether they are true to the properties of the distribution involved. So I will allow you to play with this. So this is something that I have checked. So let me generate. Okay, so there you go. This is just generating the random. Okay, now you see that there is a drift involved. Your particle is, you know, very resistant to return to the origin now. It's going to run away. But slowly, because it's only 0.55. So in fact, on average, it has a speed now. That speed of going away from the origin is p minus q, right? So if p is equal to q, then you can say that there is no drift velocity as such. It's equally likely to go to the right or to the left, and therefore you can actually show that if you wait long enough, it will for sure come back to the origin. That's another very interesting question in itself, right? So this is what people call first passage inform, but that's not the discussion right now. So right now we are just looking at what happens to the biased random walk. The biased random walk will make it go further and further away from the origin. That's what will happen. It's not, see, you see that it's hardly ever going below the x-axis. That's because it's more likely to move to the right. Okay, now homework is to check that this m squared, average of m squared, is n times n minus 1 times 2p minus 1 the whole squared, right? I have worked this out, and now I want you to use, you know, the same type of code as here, but do some small modifications and check that the biased random walk corresponds to this equation. And then I also have data for the histogram. That's also homework, right? So I have data for, let's check this. Yeah, so this has to be run afresh. Well, I mean, I said homework, but I also have the code here and I have already shown it to you. So maybe you should find your own way of doing it as well, in addition to what I have here. Yeah, so it's still running. So give it another 30 seconds. I think it should be completed. There you go. So now if I plot this, so earlier when I was plotting, it was getting data from the older one and therefore it was not agreeing. But indeed, now it is very beautifully quadratic in nature. It's x into x minus 1 times 2p minus 1 whole squared. So I would urge you to actually not look at my solution, but work out your own solution and check it yourself, and then only cross check against my solution. And then I don't give you the solution now for Pn of m. It's, you can work out something very similar to this problem, you know, and do the bias problem to write a piece of code which will give you, generate numerically Pn of m for the bias random walk, right? That's going to be very illuminating. It's going to be a useful exercise, and I urge you all to do this. All right, so what have we done in this module? So the main thing is that, once again, I emphasize, the key result to take home is that average of m squared goes as n, is equal to n, in fact, for the discrete random walk. And we have managed to verify this numerically as well. And the data sits right on top of the analytical expectation. We also managed to do it for the biased random walk. And as homework, you will verify that the probability distribution also works out, both analytically and numerically. Thank you.